Father God, this moment, for this day, which is the preparation day, we need to secure one of us have. Father, we move that as we study the word, rest of the word. Father, thank you for this time that you give me to sit down, to be in your word. So I ask you, Father, we move this as we study, and as we put these words be in our hearts, that we shall not disappoint thee, but to uplift thee, Father, thank you for all. As we know, two or three gathered are in the midst of you, Father, you among us. As we bow to you, God in us, help us to have clearly what's understanding of what's before. Father, thank you for this time. We give you praise for who you are. In your son Jesus' name, we say, amen. So God today is asking us, are we wanting to be His? As always, I love it. This morning, when we first came, we became an Adventist, Seventh-day Adventist, and a gentleman from the Sunday church came to me, coming in all awkward, but the Spirit of the Lord gave me this verse right here. 1 John 3:1-3, which is the first part of it says, see how great the love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called children of God. When He appears, we shall be like Him, because when we see Him, mistakes. In the last part of it says, every man who has this hope will fix or purify themselves just because he is pure, to the fact that he is pure. Because we know in the law and everything says that our sins are things capable of from the full knowledge of God or righteousness of God. But as he is God, he came to this world to show us and give us, as we know in John 3:16, but we, most people forget about 17 and 18, but 17 says that he came to the world to condemn the world, but the world through him by him can be saved. But the world, you know, today is trying to seek their own lust and their own desire and their own merits, and then go to God that way. But God today is saying, to know of my son, as you know of my son, you know of me, as you know of him. We want to purify ourselves to be as Him. As we know, our God is—he really has no figure. He pretty much has translucent. As you know, in the Chronicles say that as they gave forth praises unto the Lord, our God came into the sanctuary, and He came as a pillar of smoke. Even the priest cannot speak. So when that the Lord is transparent, we need to be transparent. So the world see us. And by seeing us, they see God within us. We know in Proverbs, it says, death and life are in the power of the tongue. So why would Solomon say that the power, the death of life is in the tongue? Anyway,
brother. Well, you can hurt or you can bless with the same instrument. Same thing can bless. life or curse?
Curse. Mm-hmm.
I'll go with that. Can't say it better than that.
Well, we know with the tongue, we can uplift somebody. We can tear down somebody. As we know how God was in the beginning, the only time he put his hands on something was man, but with everything else, God just spoke everything into existence. But that's the power right there that anybody would, as we know in Genesis 1:27 says, in the likeness of the Lord. Well, the likeness of the Lord, we know the likeness is his character, the joy which is of when we go, even like, I know when somebody goes to garden, was to do something like that, he or she really feel that it can be described. How that feeling is when you do something and then next thing you know, something pops up. That's how God was. But when Genesis 1:28, God says, I give you all power to subdue all things. With if you look at the word subdue is to bring under like your under your thumb, on your finger, as in Adam was to was supposed to be to till the land. So whatever he did and everything and all he did was supposed to be in the world empowering him. As we know how Jesus was able to calm the winds and the waters. That's kind of how we're supposed to act. So that tongue, as Jesus told the wind and water to calm down, is the same power that we have today when we seek to do the will of God. As we know when we do right with our God, it's not just speaking foolishness. I like when that's one thing I like about Proverbs says, to avoid to be in the folly of men. Can I have somebody read 1 Peter 1:15-16? 1 Peter.
1 Peter 1.
Yes, sir. 15-16.
Okay, I'm reading from the Voice New Testament. 15-16, right?
Yes, sir.
Since the one who called you is holy, be holy in all you do. For the scripture says, you are to be holy, for I am holy. If you call on the Father who judges everyone without partiality according to their actions, then you should live in reverence and awe while you live out the days of your exile.
Amen. So, the seventh and only day, our conversation should be holy.
What?
So it's seventh, the only day that we should, should be speaking
holy.
That we should be speaking holy. So, the word is
no.
No.
A big no.
God said in Psalms 34:1, O bless the Lord at all times. His presence shall be continually. Again, I stress this, continually be in our mouth. But the Psalms it says, in my mouth. But I'm saying in our mouth. As my wife stressed, this is why I stressed it today, that I'm not myself, but I'm one. So I say we. say my brother one time. I had a conversation with him shortly after our grandmother passed away. He was talking foolishness to me. I threw the barber at him. And he said, he told me to stop it. He said, even my grandmother don't do no descriptions like that. Like, dude, you're really foolish. Fooling yourself. You know, grandma lived a life, and even why, that's why she was praised in the church when she passed away, because her life was aligned with the scriptures. It's not the fact that she was she was single all this time, that she didn't wear anything, or she didn't have another man, but this fact that, you know, the Bible says that God, He's a father to fathers and husband to the husbands. And God was what my grandmother considered her completely. So as she didn't have a husband, so she was sticking close to God, and you know, she was influenced to as in the world. Even though her sister was married, but she didn't see to get married again. But the thing is, for us not to be not to go against the word of God. Again, don't let anyone tell you who you're not, and influence you to go against that what God said. Kind of somewhere read Luke 10:29.
Jesus began to pray, and the disciples tried to stay awake, but their eyes grew heavier and heavier, and finally they fell asleep. When they awakened, they looked over at Jesus and saw something inexplicable happening. Jesus was changing before their eyes. Beginning with his face, it seemed to glow. The glow spread, and even his clothing took on a blinding whiteness. Then two figures appeared in the glorious radiance emanating from Jesus. The three disciples somehow knew that these figures were Moses and Elijah. Peter, James, and John overheard the conversation that took place among Jesus, Moses, and Elijah. A conversation that...
10:29.
Did I go too far? I'm sorry.
No, 10:29.
The scholar was frustrated by this response, because he was hoping to make himself appear smarter than Jesus. Ah, but who is my neighbor? Is that what you wanted?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's why I was wanting you to say something. Just not like your brothers go through.
I like his version.
Can I have you to read Matthew 40 and 45.
And the king shall answer.
No, 40 and 45.
40 and 45. And the king shall answer and say unto him, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Then shall he answer them, saying, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it to one of these least of these, ye did it not to me.
So what is Jesus saying about others? So how we should treat others?
We're supposed to treat our neighbors as ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Or really, like, what do you say?
If you don't, then
as much as done to either one of these, it's done unto me. So as we need to treat each other as Christ's own, like I like how Walter says it, is like we all God's high comorbidities. Like it might give you some depression, so you can just handle it carelessly. You will take care of it. That's what people today doing when they got children. They don't want to take care of the full benefits of blessings that which is they have received. But in that which they would have, God gave them that. It's a prize. Even our own lives, we need to take care of our bodies and everything. That's why I pray that all of it's drinking, smoking, I wish they would just see what's really before them. Like for myself, what helped me stop smoking? I know prayer was one, giving my life to God was one, but before it was a process, I was like, why am I smoking cigarettes and cigars? Why am I doing this? I can't do it in the church house. And the Bible says that I am the church, temple of God. So why, if I can't do it in the physical sanctuary, so why would I typically leave? As a saying, if we take one step to God, God will take, if we take one step to God, God will take 3, 4, 5 more to get closer to us and to supply our needs. As we know, Jesus once said, He said, treat others, they treat us. I forgot what it was. Somebody said this a little contrary to what it is. Like if somebody treats you bad, you treat them right the same way you were bad. But in the aspects of it, we got to take it a little bit farther to encompass that which they all told us. We know as God wants us to be holy, and we need to be as holy. So I can ask somebody to read 2 Peter 1:4-7. 2 Peter 1:4-7.
Okay. Through these things we have received God's great and valuable promise, so we might escape the corruption of worldly desires and sharing the divine nature. To achieve this, you will need to add virtue to your faith, and then knowledge to your virtue. To knowledge, add discipline. To discipline, add endurance. To endurance, add godliness. To godliness, add affection for others as sisters and brothers. And to affection, at last, add love.
Sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour.
Satan has devoured us in the power of tongue, and we know, as I read today, Matthew 11 says, the trouble that man will have is not in the world. It will be in his own home, with his own family members. It will be somebody so close to you. It's like how Pastor brought forth that in the Bible study in Matthew and the Beatitudes, it says that you're talking about how those that know you best would be the one that persecute you. How they could be the ones that break you down and expose you. And he said those kind of people would be like your teachers, your preachers, your cousins, whoever, somebody that knows you. And you know, in Matthew 10 says that they will be the one that take you to the judges and turn you in. But you know, Satan is also a part of this, as we know how there is so much different denominations, and how back in the day the Waldensians, the Vangelines, the Nashikots was they are no more. You know, in prophecies that there was 10 horns and one horn, the three is the vendor.
Get behind me, you tempter. You're thinking only of human things, not of the things of God, of the things God has planned.
We know in this aspect, he was not talking to Peter. It's all said that, like I just said, that in 1 Peter 5, 8, Satan goes out likened to destroy those. In 2 Peter 1, 4, 7 is, if somebody treats you bad, you need to go a little farther than from returning the favor, is going towards it. It says not to repay with evil. So we need to give more, give kindness. As I'm saying, that Jesus in the time to Peter, telling him to get behind him. But like I said, it said to get behind him. And, you know, Satan, between them and us, we know that how, when we go to God, I don't know how the world came up with this, but they said when we pray, we bring God down to us, to the earth. That's definitely wrong. But as it is, as Paul said, as absent from the flesh to be present with God, this is what he's talking about, to be in prayer with God. When we pray with God, no matter where we are, we can be in jail, we can be like those 21 men who's getting tormented before they was killed. They prayed. They was not here with this earth no more. They was up there with God in the most holy place, in the throne of God, in the presence of God, giving their supplications. They didn't even pray for themselves, pray for the families and all the persons. Because it's like the disciples said, it's a blessing to be persecuted for our God. Ladies and gentlemen, 21 men got their throats cut. They praised God through all of their torments. But we know Jesus wasn't telling you to get behind him, he's telling Satan to get behind him. So as Jesus telling Satan to get behind him, we have to be the same. But we have to have the whole reason why Jesus said what he said. We can go to Matthew 16:22.
As Jesus spoke of the things to come, Peter took him aside, sad and confused, and maybe a little bit prideful. Peter chastised Jesus. No, Lord, never. These things that you are saying, they will never happen to you. Turning to Peter, that's in parentheses. Get away from me, Satan. That's 23, I'm sorry.
In Mark 8:33 says that Peter took Jesus aside, but in Matthew says that Jesus took him aside. As we know how in the heavenly places, when Lucifer had his, if you go to Isaiah 14, 12 through 14, it says that he thought he was thinking of being higher than God, or being as God, or having all the angels to fall down bow to him, as he is God. But in that aspect, that God pulled him to side and said, Lucifer, why is you flowing this way? And he hated so much, but God can see through all of that. If you go to Ezekiel 28, it shows what he did. And like I say, Isaiah 14 is the mind of Satan, and it's also Satan. But in Ezekiel 28 is the actions of him. As we know, is temptation sin? No. It's the action of sin. As the saying is, you can't stop words from front of your head. Stop it from making this on your hair, or on your head, but that's your thoughts. Your thoughts just pop in, but you manifest that thought, or it will soon become, as it will become enticing to do But as we know, in, we read earlier in Isaiah, I mean, in 1 Peter 1, 15 through 16 is the conversation. When you speak good things, all good things should be in your head. It's like when people say, as they battle pornography, they say, oh, I should not think of these things. But when you say it like that, you're putting thoughts in your head. But as you say, I shall keep my mind focused, stayed on God. Right there, you read your mind, stayed on God. But as you say, I try not to think of whoop-de-whoop-whoop in your thoughts. But if you like wife said, if you take some bad from somebody, you gotta replace it for good. So when somebody get pornography, they got. Once again, in Mark 8:33 it says, but turning, seeing his disciple, he rebuked Peter and said, get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. What is this that Jesus said to watch for that we can find? What is this that Jesus said to watch for that we can find in Matthew 24? The first part of what Jesus said, do not be, in Matthew 24, Jesus said, do not be, do not be, Matthew 24.
24 what?
When he starts speaking to the people, I think he said like three or four times in three different, or four times in three verses. He just said, do not be.
Do not believe him.
Jesus said, do not be deceived. That's all this is. This Peter was deceived of earthly thing, and he'll be deceived by the thoughts.
What verse it is?
I'm thinking it will be like all I know is in three verses. It says, do not be deceived, do not be deceived. Say, well, which one do you see, Riley?
Take care that you are not deceived, for many will come in my name, claiming they are the anointed one, and many poor souls will be taken in.
It says, do not be deceived, you said like three or four times in that one chapter, or four times in three verses.
24:4.
Yeah, that was 24:4. Let me go back to 3.
This is when Jesus starts speaking. He said, when they asked him, when this is coming, he said, there will be so many things that are happening. But he says,
24:24 is like, for there shall rise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, and so much that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect.
Yeah, we got to be, even though it says even elect, as we know, Elamites, the visions of power were like candles burning bright, but then there was a big storm, a big gust of wind blows. the candles. Some candles went out, but my policy, they all went out. But you know how like those candles that you people put on a breast case, and they blow it up, and they set it, lit back up. Some of those candles did like that. Some didn't come back, but some candles that was not even lit yet became lit brighter than the light, brighter than the light of the candles that were before them. So as I'm thinking of this, as my sister, she seen the evidence within me. I didn't get a chance to see it, but my mother, and her siblings at a young age, was introduced to the Seventh-day Adventists, the foundation of it. But as they were children, they lost sight of it. But as they were deceived of the city, the town they were in, they not compromised. They didn't stand their ground. They eventually went to go on church on Sunday. But as I just got through hearing a sermon about how a script or a play, if the play says for a person from the left come in, the person from the right come in, the person from the left sit down, the person on the right lay down, and the person from the right, instead of landing, he sits down, it's like the person on the left. And is that in the script? No, it's not in the script, but one person can depict, not a person from the casting, but only the director can. The director is God. Deception, as I was saying, deception. From the Council to the Church, chapter 33. The topic is criticism and effects. The Lord is testing and improving his people. You may be just as severely critical with your own defective character as you please, but be calm, pitiful, and courteous toward others. Inquire every day, am I sound to the core, or am I false hearted? Entreat the Lord to save you from all deceptions. On this point, internal interests are involved. While so many they're panting after the honor and greed of gain, do you, my beloved brother, be eager, seeking the assurance of the Lord of God and crying, who will show me how to make my calling and election sure? Council to the Church, 179.2, Isaiah 59:19. Shall come, as we know in James says that we resist the devil and he must flee. Just think the same mentality that Jesus had when he rebuked Satan. Just think if Eve had the same power, not the same, just the same as the serpent did. Because we know what happened to Satan, what happened to Eve was flattery. Flattery is not of the Lord. I forgot the book, but tomorrow or so, but check out this book called Christ Ways of Affirmation by Philip Simone. That's the opposite of deception. Affirmation. The beginning of this was how we're supposed to treat others, how we're supposed to speak to others, we're supposed to affirm them. How things is like how if you read that book, talk about you got a section of friends, women, yourself. Flattery is the whole deception of breakdown of man because it's not of God. Flattery, but affirmation of God, affirmation of sureness. As we know, I just said that we gotta make our literature. Heavenly places. To a church, Christ has given ample facility that they may receive a large avenue of glory from his redeemed purchase. The church has been laid down with right of use of Christ in this depository in which his mercy, his love, his grace is to. You want to go get the element. This is not right. It's not written. Can you get the element out? To a church, Christ has given ample facility that he may receive a large revenue of glory from his redeemed purchased possession. The church being the down righteous of Christ, of his depository, in which the wealth of his mercy, his love, his grace is to appear in full and final display. The declaration of his intercessory prayer with the Father's love is as great toward us as toward himself. by myself. I used to breed pit bulls, and I used to sell dogs, and that's how I used to sell them. But that's how it was growing. They didn't like it. But they really had sexuality on the TV and converting our children's mind. But it's maybe something like a little puppy. Being safe, making us half way back to the owner, meaning the seller. Then the seller said, oh, I'm going to make it back, but I'll get you sold on GoDaddy. But as I said, that the Holy Spirit, God, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost will be happy when we make it to heaven. And so, like, worshipful and abundant, it should be his church rejoicing, you know. But since it's like the last day of Black history, I'll bring it back up. But surely he is one of our griefs. We carry our sorrows. Yet we stand stricken, smitten by God, afflicted. Isaiah 53:4. God took the punishment that we should have had, but he affirmed us, saying, you see, is your accuser around? Is any of your accusers around? So get up, sin no more. So as he bore our sin, as we took upon his righteousness, he took upon our sin, and that's why he said, Father, why you forsaken me? As the Bible was saying, what we should do for others, better to be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowness of mind, let each esteem others better than us. Philippians 2:3, New King James Version. But we have to uplift others. That's the affirmation. The closing hymn. Check on his go see if there is another see if there's another don't let anybody tell you. Yeah, I just didn't say it, but converted to Saint Leftism in 1890s and was a member of Washington D.C. First Church. She lived 1839 to 1906. This right here, he's a, you can tell his complexion, he's a creepy. I know this right here, Lord C. Sheffield is a trailblazer for Black Seventh-day Adventism in Washington, D.C. He was an important and controversial figure. He lived 1859 to 1938, and he's right here with color. This is the first Black Seventh-day Adventist pastor right here. She was the first Black woman to go overseas to France to do a overseas ministry. And he was the Andy Knight was the first one to go. That's her name, Andy Knight. Andy Knight was the first to go to India to do missionary. And Charles. This is Charles Kennedy. He was the first Black ordained. Eugene Harding, one of the first Black Seventh-day Adventists. He's the first Black Seventh-day Adventist. But his name is E.E. something. We know this. I got her books, she got a good book. Her name is Sojourner Truth. Wayne Floyd. All these people were here on the outside. All these people were outside the answers. Sojourner Truth. We know what this is. Robin, who's he? Who's he? She went against the Millerites. She was an active activist. Yep. Who lectured Millerites, and later became a Seventh-day Adventist, and she later became, she was buried with Bella Creek, a little bit far from Illinois.
Because
tell you later on today, because I can't think of his name. But I also got him on Facebook. But he's a pastor, president. But he's talking about how, and there's 19 things he said, there's within 19 things in to be done in our month, in 28 days. It's funny, like I said, to minimize our significance. And it's supposed to be a month of Black History Month, but all the things that have nothing to do with black culture, black history. But like I said, dog show, car show, all these things, but minimize. But you can go back to,
stranger on earth, a sinner by choice.